Hello everyone and welcome to the workshop. Today we're going to be taking a look at a pretty unique single board computer, the Radxa X2L. This board is a crossover between a mini PC and a Raspberry Pi. It has an Intel X86 CPU on it, just like on a mini PC, but it also has a 40-pin GPIO, just like you see on the typical single board computer. Before we get into the details of how this board works, let's take a look at the hardware up close. So on top of the board, we have the Intel J4125 right here. It's a 2.7 gigahertz, 4 cores, 4 threads with integrated graphics. We have the EMMC chip. I have more information on how the EMMC is used. It's not the typical usage that you see on single board computers. This board that I got has 8 gigabytes of RAM and they're all here on the side. Moving over to this side of the board, we have two USB 2.0 connectors. Moving to the bottom of the board, we have the USB-C power jack. We have the Ethernet. It does 1 gigabit per second Ethernet. Two USB 3.0, two HDMI ports, and audio output with mic in. The fan header is right here, and there's a M.2 connector for Wi-Fi modules. And right here in the center of the board, you can see the RP2040 and the GPIO header. So moving to the bottom of the board, there's no SD card slot, but we have a full 2280 M.2 connector for SSDs. And pretty much nothing else besides the CMOS clear button. Since this is a single board computer, and when we think about SBCs, we think about Raspberry Pi, here's the X2L next to a Pi 5. It's a little bit bigger than the flagship Raspberry Pi computer, but not that much bigger. The X2L is supposed to be roughly the size of an iPhone Pro. Hold on a second, are iPhones really this big now? The X2L is a bit of an odd duck, but a cute odd duck. It doesn't have the same expandability as traditional mini PCs since there's no SATA ports or PCIe slots, but it's super small and it has GPIO pins. It's like a mini PC and the Raspberry Pi had a cute baby. You might look at this board and think, that's really cool. I'd love the flexibility of an Intel X86 CPU with built-in GPIO. I can have my Python apps, Node-RED automation, tap into my GPIO. I can do a lot of cool things, right? Well, it doesn't quite work that way. On a traditional SBC like a Raspberry Pi, the CPU controls the GPIO pins. On the X2L, there's an RP2040 microcontroller chip that is independent from the main Intel CPU, and the RP2040 is what controls the GPIO. Although the main CPU and the RP2040 can communicate through serial interface, you need a script on both ends sending information back and forth to get that to work. This back and forth makes things a little bit more complicated to code, but it's not that bad. In essence, the way the X2L works is the same thing as having this Pico just glued to one of the USB ports on a PC. Let me show you what I mean. I have a thermocoupler connected to the GPIO on the X2L, and on a traditional SBC, I would be able to read this information directly from the GPIO. On the X2L, it's different. In this example, I have the RP2040 listening for serial communication from the Intel chip. The Intel side of things will send a message saying like, hey, read the temperature. This message is formatted as JSON just because I chose so. The RP2040 will then receive the message and it will act and read the temperature from the sensor. This is only one-way communication. If you want to have two-way communication, It gets a little bit more complex because you need to account for receiving serial communication on the Intel side of things. So the RP2040 has to send information back to the Intel side. I have a blog post with more information on how to set this up on the X2L, and you know where to find the link. So okay, enough about the GPIO stuff. You're probably watching this video to know more about how this board compares to other SBCs or even other mini PCs, right? First, let's talk about price, because the price of this board puts everything into perspective. The base model with only 2 gigs of RAM costs $39 without shipping. This is cheaper than a Pi 4 with 2 gigabytes of RAM. The 4 gigabyte version is only $52, which is a couple bucks cheaper than the Pi 4 and $8 cheaper than the Pi 5. Most surprisingly, the 8 gigabyte version of the X2L is $72. Once again, cheaper than the Pi 4 and the Pi 5 with the same RAM. Performance-wise, this is a very decent board for its price point. If you compare it to the Pi 4, which is about as old as this Intel chip, it just blows the Pi 4 out of the water. I mean, it's in a different league. But the J4125 chip is 4 years old and it's starting to show its age. For instance, it performs worse than the ROG chip 3588, which is kind of the gold standards nowadays for SBCs. The ROG chip 3588 is what you find on the ROG 5B, which is a board that I have compared the Pi 5 to in past videos. But the ROG 5B is about twice the price of the X2L. There are other differences too though, not just the raw performance of the CPU from the ROG 5B to the X2L. So, you know, pros and cons to everything in life. The J4125 also has a hard time competing with newer embedded chips that we see on mini PCs these days. A good example is the Intel N100, which I have here in my workshop and I'm working on a build with it. But I don't think this board is competing with the Intel N100. The N100 mini PCs are not really in the embedded device space. At least I don't think about them that way. It's not like you can send an N100 mini PC on a weather balloon. Although, I can see this little guy, the X2L, raising into the stratosphere, I think it can. What about virtualization? The J4125 chip is capable of virtualization, meaning you can install Proxmox on this board and have virtual machines on your Proxmox running other OSs. If you're a home labber, I hate the term home labber. Anyway, if you're a home labber, you're probably familiar with Proxmox. If you're planning on using this board as a Proxmox host though, I would definitely go with the 8 gigabyte version because 2 and 4 gigabytes of RAM will only get you so far once you start spinning up virtual machines inside of Proxmox. I haven't tested it as a virtualization host, but I don't see why it would be an issue since people have been using Proxmox on systems with the J4125 for years now. Virtualization might be one of the main selling points for this board, especially at $72. Although it is possible to install a port of Proxmox on the Raspberry Pi 5, there are pretty big caveats that Andreas covered in his recent video. He wasn't able to boot VMs using Raspberry Pi OS, and many of the containers didn't work on the Pi 5. So Proxmox on a Pi 5 is doable, but far from perfect. Virtualization is also great for those that want many OSs or services running at the same time, but you only want one machine plugged into the wall. An X2L running 3 virtual machines uses less power than 3 Raspberry Pi 5 plugged into the wall, so that's something to think about. Power consumption on the X2L is pretty good, hovering around 5 to 7 watts on idle.
This is a little bit higher than the usual 4 to 5 watts on the Raspberry Pi, but again, this is not an ARM computer. Under load, the power consumption can spike up to 12 watts once it settles under load. I actually saw some short spikes to 17 watts under load, meaning you need a pretty good quality PSU that can handle these short spikes. The documentation says that it requires a power brick that can supply at least 18 watts, but a 24 watt power supply is recommended. At least that's what I think they mean. The current information on the product page is not clear at all. I've been using the Radxa 30 watt power adapter and it has been working flawlessly. If you're thinking about powering this board with a power bank, be careful though, because most power banks are only able to supply 9 volts at 2 amps, so that's 18 watts, and it's pretty hard to find a power bank that can supply 12 volts at 2 amps, which would be 24 watts. Although the X2L is able to boot with this power bank that I have here, this power bank only supplies 18 watts. It's not stable at all, and during those spikes, it does crash. It has crashed many times on me. So I think that the 24 watt recommended PSU is really more of a requirement than a recommendation. Definitely keep that in mind. I also tested it with the official Raspberry Pi 5 PSU and it worked really well, which is not surprising since the Radxa PSU and the Pi 5 PSU are very similar in specs. So keep power requirements in mind when shopping for a power supply for the X2L, because not all USB-C PSUs will work for you. But Andre, you're a Pi guy. Are you telling me to forget Raspberry Pis and buy the X2L instead? No, that's not what I'm saying. There are quite a few use cases that I see the Pi 5 as a better option, as a matter of fact. The X2L is an x86 system, and installing a new OS is not as easy as on a Pi or any other ARM SBCs, where all you have to do is flash a microSD card in just a couple minutes and you're ready to boot. On a traditional SBC, if you completely hose the system, you just reflash the SD card or plug in another one and it's no big deal. On the x86 system though, it takes a good 10 to 15 minutes to install a new OS, and you have to deal with managing drive partitions, boot volumes, BIOS settings. You get what I mean, it's just not as easy. A board like the Pi 5 has more specialized connectivity. If the project you're working on requires a small touchscreen display, for instance, well, the X2L doesn't have that. On the X2L, you're limited to HDMI displays only. Heck, on a Pi 5, you can even connect one of those tiny little GPIO interface displays. This is also technically possible on the X2L, but the display would be controlled by the RP2040 chip and not the main Intel CPU, so not the same thing. Camera connectivity is another area where the Pi 5 just shines. Regular SBCs have a MIPI connector for cameras that allow you to use specialized camera modules like the ArduCam or the Raspberry Pi cameras. Like this camera from Raspberry Pi that I have here that I use in a bunch of my projects. Again, the X2L doesn't have a MIPI connector and you're limited to USB cameras only. And you know, the Pi 5 can also do USB cameras, so that's not really a plus for the X2L. By the way, I bought this board with my own money and I plan on using it in a cool project that I have in mind. This is really just my opinion while using it for a few weeks now and planning my project around it. I do have more videos planned on this board in the future, so stay tuned. So where does the X2L shine? Well, if you're planning on using a Raspberry Pi or SBC as a server system, you might want to consider this board instead. If you want to run like Home Assistant or other automation software like Node-RED, this is great for that. I also think this can be a pretty awesome HDMI retro gaming system. It's super compact and can easily fit in one of those super cool tabletop arcade cabinets, if the arcade cabinet has HDMI display, which most of them do anyway. Another thing is, because the X2L is an X86 system, driver support is so much better than in the ARM world. For instance, it doesn't have onboard Bluetooth, but you can add it through an expansion card. I plugged in this Wi-Fi and BLE combo card, and it was recognized right away by the OS. No additional setup needed, which is usually not the case in the ARM SBC world. I was pretty happy that I was able to connect my Xbox S-Series controller through Bluetooth to my X2L with no issues at all. Last time I tried doing this on a Pi 4 running RetroPie, it was an ordeal. I ended up just giving up and was using this controller just hooked up through a USB cable to my Pi 4. Standard drivers and hardware support is definitely a big win for the X2L over the general ARM SBC landscape. Alright, we're almost getting to the end. There's only one more quirky thing about this board that I want to cover. There's a version of this board that comes with 8GB of RAM and includes 32GB of EMMC, which is this version that I have here. The version with the EMMC costs $10 more than the version without EMMC. On most single board computers, EMMC is just another media that you can use to load your OS, use it as a boot drive, or just store your files. And you have probably guessed what I'm going to say, that's not how EMMC works on the X2L. On the X2L, EMMC is only accessible when you power up the board while pressing the EMMC physical button on the board. There's no way you're going to be doing that every time you boot up the board, so. The EMMC on this board is really meant for a recovery OS. So if things go horribly wrong and you completely hose the system, you can boot from EMMC and get a recovery OS loaded into your boot media. It's a neat feature, but I don't really have a use for it myself. I just wish I had known this before buying my X2L, and I would have definitely saved the $10 that I spent extra on the EMMC version. In true Radxa style, this is not mentioned in the documentation. I only found this out through this forum thread. Really? Really? Why didn't you put that in the documentation? So, what are my thoughts on this board? If you're looking for a maker board with camera connectivity, display connectivity, GPIO, you should probably look into the Pi 5 or another traditional SBC. But if you're looking for a low-cost server board that you can leave running 24/7 and not worry about electricity bill, this board is pretty awesome for that. It's pretty small and can probably fit in an embedded project. It has GPIO through the RP2040 chip, and it works really well. I think I'm gonna have some fun working with this board. Alright everyone, I think this is it for this video. Let me know in the comments below what you thought about the X2L. Are you planning on getting it? Do you have a project in mind that the X2L would be perfect for? Just let me know in the comments. Anyway, I'll see you in the next one.